Reverend John Dunlop and Dr. Tom Frawley, I just wanted to begin by thanking both of you for making the trip here from Northern Ireland to visit us for the week at the University of Wyoming. I know it's a bit of a journey across the sea, but we really appreciate the time you coming here and traveling to be with us. And where I was thinking we might begin our conversation today is just if you could tell us a little bit about your own background and maybe the nature of your current work in Northern Ireland today. And maybe John, we can begin with you.
Well, I was born in Newry, which is just north of the border, in 1939. So that tells you I'm 76 years old. Mm. Having graduated from Queen's University in Belfast and the University of Edinburgh, I then got married. And my wife and I went to Jamaica for 10 years. So we worked with the church in Jamaica. I'm a Presbyterian minister. Mm. Worked with the church in Jamaica. Then came back to Belfast and was the minister of Rosemary Church in North Belfast. Mm. And I was there for 26 years until I retired. So I've retired 11 years ago. So at present I preach on Sundays and I keep a general interest in what's going on in the place and try to engage with people. I did a lot of work when I was in North Belfast in reconciliation work and peace building and trying to help the two communities to understand one another. Or the two parts of the one community, perhaps I should say, to enable them to try to understand one another, where they were coming from, what their experiences were. So that was quite challenging work because it took you into some quite difficult situations.
And is that work you're still engaged in today?
Well, to a lesser degree, because I held responsibility in the church for 10 years. No, for much longer than that, but particularly for a number of years, I was convener of the Church and Government or the Church and Society Committee. And that was in the period coming up with the Good Friday Agreement. So I was engaged at that stage with the political leaders in an informal way, encouraging them to try to reach some kind of reconciliation. Talking to Sinn Féin, sometimes at the height of the trouble of some of the Sinn Féin people, to ask them to try to understand me and the community that I come from, because they were saying that their problem was Britain and they wanted Britain out. And I said, well, people, London would leave Northern Ireland tomorrow if the majority of people in Northern Ireland wanted that to be the case. So I said to them that their political analysis was wrong, and therefore the campaign of violence built upon a flawed political analysis was going absolutely nowhere, and that I was their problem, not Britain, not London. Therefore they had to come to terms with how they could make peace with me and the community that I'm a part of, and that we in turn had to try to make peace with them. So that was the guts of the political argument. It was tough stuff, and you were talking to people in many ways you prefer not to talk to, but nevertheless you had to do it. And therefore to try to provide some leadership for the church and in doing television interviews and radio interviews to try to enable other people out in the society to participate in the journey that I had been on myself. And you'd be sensitive to the people who are listening to you or the people who are watching you on television. So you're a kind of, not a political negotiator, because that's a job for politicians. So it's important to understand where the church sits in this and where people like I would sit on it. So I could encourage politicians to engage in talks and try to reach an accommodation with one another. The churches could create an environment for political accommodation as possible without them actually getting engaged in the detailed negotiations, because the detailed negotiations are for those people who are the elected politicians. That's their job. And of course the negotiations are extraordinarily complex, so that if you're not more or less up to date with that on a day-to-day basis, you don't actually know what's going on. So it's a hard job to actually stay in touch with all of that stuff, but necessary if you're going to be engaging with it in a creative and responsible kind of way. So that was what I did for a long time, as well as being a parish minister. I mean, my primary responsibility was as a parish minister, looking after the congregation and preaching on Sundays and providing leadership at that local level. And at the same time, building relationships with the Catholic community, with the Catholic Church, which are neighbouring congregations. So you had the Catholic parish, you had the Anglican Church, the Church of Ireland, you had the Methodists, the Presbyterians, which were the four big denominations. So we did a lot of joint work there, which doesn't always happen in Northern Ireland, but the relationship between the church leaders are good, but whether the relationship on the ground is good or not depends on the leadership at the local level. So that's what I did. It took up a lot of my time. It was challenging work, but it was good to have a go at it.
Thank you. Tom?
Well, I'm sort of, I suppose, very different to John in this sense. I was born in Limerick in the south of Ireland in 1949, so that makes me 66 years of age. Mm-hmm. I came to Belfast at 11, which was a huge, huge cultural shift for me. Mm-hmm. Very different environment, very different place, very different sort of feel to it, I think. And then when I was 17, I went to Trinity at a time when Catholics should not go to Trinity, we were advised by the then Archbishop of Dublin. And that was a really new experience again, totally immersed in a different environment. I came back to Belfast and I was recruited onto a graduate training scheme for the National Health Service. Mm-hmm. And I then had a career that took me all over Northern Ireland in the health service. Ultimately arriving in Derry, Londonderry, depending on your prejudice, in 1980. Like most people who go to Derry from Belfast, I assumed I'd be home in a couple of years. I'm still there. I've grown to love the place, but in Irish terms or Northern terms, I'm still a blow-in. I'm not one of us. I've come from somewhere else. But it is a really interesting city, and I would describe it as the cockpit of the Troubles, really. It was when this particular phase of Troubles, if you like, 1969, civil rights and so on, commenced. And so I've sort of had a very different perspective on the Troubles from that point of view. I then ended up running that whole health system for 20 years, which is very challenging. And I traversed all those communities in the west of Northern Ireland. So I think John's community in North Belfast suffered more than any other community, I think, if you look at the statistics in terms of death, fatalities, and indeed hurt of all kinds. But the west of Northern Ireland equally. I mean, there was a general sense in the unionist community in the west, which is in the minority, that there was a sort of genocide going on against them. And that's, they use that word, and that's a very powerful and difficult word, I think. But that's how they felt, and I've no doubt at times could make the case. I didn't really, in a sense, have an explicit role in peace building, but I was on the verge of it. My brother was highly involved in politics, was a socialist, as he described himself, mm-hmm. much to my mother's consternation, who was an extremely conservative woman. He was interned for a year, which was really interesting, again, as a middle-class family, going to Longkesh, seeing that whole experience. And again, that tendency in terms of, if you want to survive in these circumstances, how do you hunker down and protect yourself from all that meant? And I obviously was working in a very senior public service job, and I continued to work in the health service until, as I say, about 2000, when I applied for the post of Northern Ireland Ombudsman, mm-hmm. which is a really interesting post, which had been created, to be fair, by the Stormont government in 1969 as one of their, I think, serious efforts to try and reduce the sense of Catholic alienation by giving a public post to someone who could investigate complaints and allegations of unfairness. And so when it came available in 2000, I applied for it, and I was very fortunate to get it. And so I've been doing that ever since. And that in turn has brought me into play in terms of many of the issues that compose the whole issue of transitional justice, and much more directly involved. Again, I am involved with the politicians in my day-to-day business. They sponsor complaints. I speak to committees in the Assembly daily, weekly. We are currently taking legislation through the Assembly. So I've got to know the politicians reasonably well. I wouldn't say that I'm in any way an advisor or a confidant of them, but I get a sense of, you know, what they're trying to do and the difficulties they experience. And I always remember a chairman of the health board, and I'll stop here, said to me, "Your problem, Frawley, is you see everyone's point of view." And I think in Northern Ireland that can be a very difficult place to be.
Hmm. Well, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit, I mean, you both kind of mentioned this just in your introductions here, but just how personal the impact was in some ways for many communities and many people individually within Northern Ireland itself, the long history of the Troubles, the long history of the conflict there. And I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about how the conflict impacted Northern Irish society, and maybe particularly how it impacted relations between Catholic nationalist or Protestant unionist communities living in Northern Ireland.
Well, my analysis of the problem was this. It goes back well, it goes back many centuries, but let's not go back as far as that. Mm-hmm. Whenever you had partition in the, just after 1920, 100 years ago, you ended up with the Republic of Ireland, what became the Republic of Ireland, being an independent country, and Northern Ireland continued as a part of the United Kingdom. So you had an island divided. And the island was marked by two unsatisfactory ideologies. The ideology in the Republic of Ireland was Irish nationalist and Catholic. And the one in the north was Protestant and Unionist. Now both of those ideologies failed to accommodate and honour minorities. So large numbers of people with a Protestant British identity simply left the Republic. Either went to Britain or came north. Or if they remained in the Republic, they kept their heads down and kept their mouths shut because you had to fit in. The northern minority were Catholic and Nationalist, and they were a disaffected group of people inside Northern Ireland who did not want the settlement which had occurred. Therefore, they thought the settlement was wrong, the accommodation or the compromise of the border was wrong. And they therefore experienced themselves as a minority community who were not honoured, who were discriminated against, and made to feel in themselves that they didn't really belong, that they were second-class citizens in that society. So you have two ideologies operating on the one island, one Irish Catholic nationalist, the other Ulster Protestant Unionism. And both of them are characterised by exclusivity and exclusion. So the ideology as a self is shaped and formed in exclusive terms. The experience of the minority is that they are being excluded. Now, whenever you come to the 1960s, which is a creative age in my life, I'm in my 20s. I've been to university from Queens, then went to Edinburgh. Second Vatican Council starts, John the 23rd, and things start to thaw. All these ecclesiological frozen misery, as one bishop put it, this begins to thaw. Things begin to change through the 60s. And relationships inside Northern Ireland generally begin to improve. You get relationships between Sean Lamass, who's the Taoiseach in the south, and Terence O'Neill in the north. They meet with one another with a lot of criticism, but they do it. John the 23rd dies. The Unionist leadership in Belfast City Council fly the Union flag at half mast to mark the death of a Pope. This is an extraordinary event that this should happen. And the Corrymeela community is established, which is an inter-church community in Northern Ireland, established by a Presbyterian minister who had been a prisoner of war in Dresden. This is where part of the inspiration came from that. You get, as Tom has said, you know, the Ombudsman's appointment in 1969 is an indication of this change coming. Then you come to 68, 69, and you get student revolts all over Europe. Right, you get student revolts in America. So students get involved. You begin to get demands for change in Northern Ireland, change which ought to have been accommodated faster than it was. And you get resistance to change. So you get the crucial years, or 68 to 70, which are the pivotal years where we run from the possibilities of gradual and consistent change into a new future. Suddenly, all falls apart into chaos, and killing and violence, all of which was unnecessary, shouldn't have happened. So we lost our way, and then we go through about 30 years of this darkness. The relationships between the communities, which were, they kind of sat beside one another without interacting with one another. But at that stage, once that happens, people don't know who to trust one another. I mean, I come from Newry. Because of the violence, mainly of Republicans in Newry, the Protestant population falls in Newry. A lot of businesses are bombed, people get killed, and people leave. And more people don't turn around. And anybody gets a Protestant who gets a job in Newry doesn't live in Newry anymore. You don't live south of Banbridge because it's not safe. So you get that sense of a community which is under threat and being diminished. So the relationship between the communities deteriorates right through the violence, because the violence intensifies division, in my opinion. And then gradually over the years you have to start then to see whether or not you can start to bring things together. The violence clearly has got to come to an end. There has to be ceasefires. Mm-hmm. My belief is that the Republican violence was brought to an end partly because it wasn't going anywhere. There was no point continuing to put large numbers of people into prison. And I think the movement was itself so heavily infiltrated by the intelligence agencies that they could do very little now without being being people knowing what was going on and that some of the activities could be subverted. You get a kind of total chaos on the Loyalist Protestant Unionist side of different factions of the UDA, the UVF, and the UFF, sometimes fighting one another, and sometimes occasionally an enormous amount of violence on the Catholic community. You've got a police service, the RUC, trying to keep peace in the middle of this, but clearly being identified with one community rather than the other community. Nevertheless, trying to contain Loyalist paramilitaries and trying to put a lot of those guys in prison. But then you get the collusion allegations in the middle of this, which means that the mistrust of the Catholic nationalist community with regard to the police increases. So at the end of all of this unnecessary catastrophic violence, you have to begin to work your way out of this, and you begin to work your way out of it in all the conversations that take place behind the scenes, off the record, negotiations behind the scenes and off the record, with eventually a very constructive involvement, I think, from the United States under the Clinton administration. You get the Irish government being involved in a very sensitive kind of way, the British government trying to make progress. So you get the major American, British and Irish governments getting involved in ways in which they're trying to understand these two communities, and they're looking for political accommodation and not the triumph of one community over the other community. And then you get to up eventually the Good Friday Agreement, and that becomes the watershed. So that's a brief Dunlop synopsis of about a bit of a century.
But of course, being Northern Irish, I couldn't settle for a Dunlop synopsis. You also have to you must hear my perspective as well. I suppose it need to be heard. I suppose as I look on at it, I mean, I think John is absolutely right in the way it happened. And I mean, I think in the late 60s there was great optimism that we could move on and find a better accommodation. I think the nationalist Catholic had always felt suspect, had never felt trusted in the Northern Ireland government arrangements there was. And I think it's acknowledged very significant discrimination around public appointments, discrimination particularly around housing and so on. And, you know, Derry was the perfect example where they will talk about the gerrymander, where you had a majority of nationalists who clearly would never be in authority in the city because they had gerrymandered the way the city was organized electorally, and that gave a permanent unionist majority. And of course, I think a lot of Derry people would say, again, it's a small detail you might say, but there it was confirmed for them that the unionist government would never, ever acknowledge them when they decided to have a second university. And Derry assumed actually it would be built at McGee College, which was a college of Trinity College in Dublin. And suddenly they announced it would be in Coleraine. And I mean, unionists and nationalists then marched to Stormont to say, this is unfair, this is unjust. But you know, at that point, that was just yet another straw in the wind. I think then they marched for fairer housing allocations. There's a famous march in Caledon in County Tyrone, led by a person who went on to be a very significant nationalist SDLP leader, Austin Curry, in relation to a house that was allocated to a Protestant young woman who was engaged against a Catholic family on the waiting list, a married couple with five children. So all of this fed the sense of this is never going to change. And I think that then you got the forces of the state felt threatened. A great mutual friend of ours, Dennis Bradley, would make the point, you need to understand, Tom, that unionism feels incredibly vulnerable, because all they need to do is lose once and it will be United Ireland, whereas nationalists can keep coming back and back. And that level of insecurity impacts everything. And I think that's still an issue for us. I alluded before this interview started to a wonderful lecture that John facilitated my attendance at by an outstanding academic and thinker, David Porter. And he used two quotes in that I'd like to share with our audience. And it describes Ireland as a small island of great hatreds. We did great harm to each other. Now these excuses haunt our future. But the other quote he said, and I think this relates to your question, cultural identity is rooted in deep sectarianism. It is the result of a profound insecurity which arises from the corrosive definition of me as not you. Now, I mean, that is, you know, just to unpack that, that's a hugely powerful statement of what we're trying to do, is to move people on from that position. And I think that particularly in the hardest of this, in places like North Belfast, where this isn't sort of some geography like West Belfast, where you have Catholics living in fairly, not in Irish terms, fairly big geographies. These are literally communities and streets, street to street, changing as you move from street to street, making, you know, life very difficult. And then you have the difficulties in places like Ardoyne, where, you know, you have this very, very dense and very significant Catholic community, nationalist community, and the unionist population feeling constantly under pressure, and the Catholic community feeling constantly under pressure, and very hard to see how you break out of that. So you sort of roll back into your identity. That's the only safe place to be. And so I think a lot of hurt is caused, and I think John does some excellent analysis of the detail of this. I think it was made most profoundly to me when the numbers would look like 3,600 people died, which in America, you know, probably relative to population doesn't seem like a major thing. But when you actually look at what would that have meant in America in terms of proportions, that would have looked like 600,000 people died against our population. And as John's analysis would show, when you then put in the people that were injured, when you then put in the people that were imprisoned, when you then put in the people that were related to those people, other people that knew those people. And you know, at the height of the troubles in West Belfast, I can remember the bin lids and the noise in a community, whether it was right or wrong, feeling completely under siege. And then, you know, in the nature of soldiers and armies coming into these streets and knocking in doors and dragging people out at 5 and 6 in the morning. So those are images that people carry, and they find it very hard to get past them. And again, you're trying to bring all that back into some sort of understanding for people, some place where they can make sense of it and move on from it. And you know, people sometimes, and this is very painful, don't find it easy to let go of all of that. So I think there's great hurt been done on all sides. And I think that's something that we really still find great difficulty in dealing with.
Yeah, let me go back to something Tom said, which I think is important. Which was described to me once by a Jewish scholar in a conference talking about Jewish self-consciousness. He referred to it as oppositional identity, that you define yourself in terms of who you're not, not in terms of who you are. Now this is disastrous really, because it means that not only are you understanding your own community, but you are opposed to that other community, and that other community is the community which is living right beside you. In fact, intersecting with your community. Now, the oppositional identity in the two communities, I think, operates in two different ways. The opposition identity inside the national community, I think, is primarily anti-British. It has got anti-English, long history behind it of antipathy and maybe great hatreds as well. So it's that negative sense of being anti-British, anti-English. When you come to the Protestant side, it is anti-Catholic. So one opposition identity is anti-English, anti-British, the other one is anti-Catholic. So it operates in two different ways. So whenever you come into the community that I'm a part of, and you begin to build relations with the Catholic Church and with Catholic people, then you begin to move across from oppositional identity to a positive appreciation of this other community, a positive appreciation of this other church. And that's a big move which goes on inside people's heads, because you're moving against the grain of the way in which they understand themselves. So you define yourself in terms of your opposition to your neighbor. And then on the other side, whenever my community ends up having got a British element to its identity, if the nationalist Catholic opposition identity is anti-British, it manifests it somewhere or other, not against my existence as a Presbyterian, because that doesn't bother them all that much, but it is against the Britishness of the part of that community that I'm a part of. So the opposition identity operates in two slightly different ways in the two communities.
And just to sort of again reflect how complicated it gets, is, and I'm sure people here have been aware of the royal visit to the Republic of Ireland, which people thought unthinkable. Mm-hmm. Now that was unthinkable on one level, but to get the warm, the rapturous welcome that the Queen got in Dublin, and particularly in Cork, which would be seen as a Republican city, completely confounds everything. So that the North is further left behind, so that now suddenly I think nationalists in the North look south and say, my goodness, you know, where have they got to and where are they? Because we don't have a lot in common with them anymore. You know, and that's another bit of the jigsaw that's making sense of. And the Britishness, I think, that the Unionists in the North talk about makes no sense to the people in Essex or Kent. What are they talking about? Why do they need to have a Union Jack flying? Why do they need to march up and down these streets? What is all that about? And then they feel even the aspiration that you have is suddenly thrown back in your face. And so all of this is going on alongside trying to make sense of your own world and what's going on in your own world and to establish relationships across these barriers and these divisions. And so I think it makes the whole task multifaceted, multi-layered, and hugely complex.
Well, you both spoke a lot about just the massive impact that the conflict had on inter-community relations in Northern Ireland and a lot of the hurt and the harm that was done as a result of this and some of those legacies that are still being grappled with in some ways around sectarianism and oppositional identities. And I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit. We're now more than 16 years on from the Belfast or Good Friday Agreement that brought an end to the overt violence of the conflict anyways. Reflecting back now in 2015, if you could talk a little bit about the current nature of intercommunity relations between Catholic nationalists or Protestant Unionists and maybe how those have changed or how they've evolved or where we're at in Northern Ireland in 2015.
I would like to maybe just begin by saying, and I say this often to people at home, sometimes you need to remember how far you've come, as distinct from how far you still have to go. So let me acknowledge we have a huge distance to travel, but I also think we have come a huge distance. And I mean, you look at what's been done in housing in Northern Ireland, the investment in public housing and housing infrastructure. You look at what's been done in the police service of Northern Ireland as compared the reform, the patent reform programs. You look at the way in which the employment arrangements have been completely modernized. And are way more robust and rigorous than you would get in England, the Republic of Ireland, and dare I say it, the States. Just the rigor that's in the process, the testing of the process to ensure fairness. Some people would even say it's got so complex and challenging it's impossible to actually recruit the people that you want because you have to go through so many hoops. So there's been huge shifts in all of that. But you know, at the core of it, there still is this fundamental problem of identity and relationship. I think there is a real issue for us around the past, which I know probably you're going to come to anyway, and trying to deal with that. And is it possible to deal with it at all? And what are the implications of dealing with it? People use this very, very powerful metaphor of, you know, currently there is a sort of a scab over a wound, and if you persist in picking at that scab, you will open that wound again, and you may not get it to heal. You may have very fundamental problems going forward. But it's very difficult not to, one, acknowledge the hurt, and two, then the question that people will ask, and what are you going to do about it? So I think that's one of the big intractables that's there. You have a whole history around the human rights piece and issues like inquests that are still outstanding. And the delays around those and the lack of openness and transparency around those for families in particular, which of course, in my view and in my daily work, when you get that lack of openness and transparency, it immediately feeds the suspicion that you're hiding something and there is something fundamentally wrong here that you won't talk about, which again feeds the monster. We've tried major inquiries. 200 million pounds sterling spent on the Savile inquiry into Bloody Sunday. A very, very powerful apology by the Prime Minister Cameron in the House of Commons. And, you know, everyone thought, well, that'll give us some closure. And yet, many of the families still say, not enough. We now know that these soldiers shot people. We now want to know who's going to prosecute them, who's going to identify them, when will we see them in court? When will we see justice done? So there's another phase of that still lies ahead of us. So all of these things, I think, continue to be a problem. But I do take real satisfaction from the progress that's been made. And I think we have to sort of just get our shoulder to the wheel and keep going at this. I mean, John is a man who's been right in the middle of it and probably has a much better sense of it than I have. But I think, you know, we have still got a lot of work to do.
I think that Tom is right, that one thing you must recognize is the journey which we've been on and the progress which has been made. I met some people one day in the car park outside a hospital. They said to me, things have never been worse. I said to them, where the heck have you been? You know, have you forgotten what things were like? So just because you run into a problem, which is the current problem, which might be quite serious, must not divert you from an appreciation of the vast amount of improvement which has taken place. And part of that is the transformation of the cities and the towns. You can now move through Northern Ireland all the time, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. In the middle of the troubles, you couldn't. Town centres were blocked off, you were constantly going through police checks, all that's finished. Cruise ships are coming into Belfast, one after the other. It's one of the major destinations for cruise ships now. Could anybody have imagined that anybody would want to come and spend a day in Belfast? So they're coming in vast numbers. Hotels are being built in Belfast all the time to try to accommodate all the tourists who want to come, and not only be in Belfast, but to see Northern Ireland. And instead of spending time exclusively in Dublin, Donegal, on the way down the south, around the delightful places in the southwest, people will now, for the first time, start to come and spend time in Northern Ireland and say, this is a quite delightful place. We never knew anything about this place. So you get a lot of American investment, you get new high-rise buildings going up, you get transformation of the physical structure of the centre of Belfast. All that is great. But there's always a button in the middle of this stuff. I was asked to work with two other people on the North Belfast Community Action Project, which was looking specifically at North Belfast and to look in some detail at what was called community capacity. And we define community capacity as the ability of a local community to have enough energy to help itself. Now, whenever you go to the Catholic Nationalist community, community capacity is well advanced because they've been dealing this stuff for a long time. Nationalist communities tend to be much more cohesive than loyalist communities because there's a single church, not 101 different options for you. There's basically one church. There's basically one big political party, which is the Sinn Féin, with the possibility of the SDLP around the edges. You go over into the other side, you get all these multitude of different Protestant churches, and you get a multitude of different political parties, and you get three big factions of terrorist of paramilitary organizations fighting, nationalists and Republicans, and fighting one another. So they're fractured. We then said about North Belfast, nobody lives in North Belfast. Nobody. They live in bits of North Belfast. So they live in the wee small identified areas, which are identified by peace lines, by walls, by curbstones, by murals. And they're living cheek by jowl, against close proximity to one another, in these small communities. And what we tried to do was to see whether or not we could set up mechanisms by which community capacity could be increased within these communities so they stop being so helpless, and begin, in addition to that, to get them to cooperate with one another. So it was trying to take you out of your small ghetto experience into something which was a bit wider. Now that has had a limited amount of success. I think it has been much more successful in the Catholic Republican part of North Belfast than it has in the Unionist one. But one has to look at the fractured nature of that and really to say this is quite a considerable problem. The people living on these so-called peace lines ought not to be condemned, because if I was living there, I would be behaving in exactly the same way. Right? So it's not as if there's some kind of inferior kind of species of people living there. They're just ordinary human beings caught in that extraordinarily difficult situation, full of fear, full of anxiety, with a lot of memories of all kinds of bad things that happened, very poor health, particularly on the Protestant side, very poor education and achievement among the working class Protestant boys is a very serious problem. So with all the progress, nevertheless, there are these problems which are existing. Then when you take it on the macro political level, which is another level, which is the Good Friday Agreement structures which were put in place, between the two main parties, the Democratic Unionist Party and Sinn Féin. The danger of these two parties is that each of them thinks that they have to look after their own constituencies, their own constituents. That means that neither of them And together they are not giving a coherent overall vision of the of Northern Ireland to its citizens. So they play partisan politics too often, rather than having cohesive politics where the things are being done together. And they keep running into problems because that kind of vision has not been articulated at that level. And since it's not been articulated, I think it's not inside people's heads, because you have to articulate, sell it, and give people a sense of vision and then live it. And too often that is lacking. So we've made progress, but there's some way still to go.
Well, one of the things, Tom, that you brought up earlier is how these attempts to deal with the past, try to come to terms or address or to look back at what happened during the conflict and somehow come to terms with it between the two communities, how in some ways important it's been, but I also think how divisive it's been in some ways. And I was just wondering if you might be able to speak a little bit about why it might be important to look back and address some of the violence that occurred during the past, some of those hurts and harms that occurred during the past for current intercommunity relations today.
Well, I think that, you know, people will carry their story with them. And it's very hard to maybe bring someone else's perspective into play. And I think yet if you're going to have any sort of settled community, I mean, I use this phrase, which I think captures it for me, a Northern Ireland at ease with itself, that then you have to begin to see the world. You have to walk in the other man's shoes. You have to try and see how this felt for them at the time, and not just how the pain and the hurt that you experienced. And it's very hard to create moments. For example, one of the big issues, huge issue, is what Sinn Féin would describe as the hierarchy of victims. That, you know, the police who were murdered, people who died in awful bombs, people who were literally taken from their homes and shot, that they understandably are the real victims of all this, and they are. But equally, their view is that their members, their active service units, whatever title they apply, were didn't get involved in this because they got involved because they had to, because of the circumstances they found themselves in, because they were defending their community at a time where clearly their community fell under attack, and they are not willing to be, you know, to take the title on board of terrorists. You know, they will use words like combatants, and you know, they will see, for example, be very opposed to any suggestion that the British are in some way an honest broker in this. They see the British as very much just a participant in this awful period. And so they don't see the British as qualified in adjudicating or judging on any of this. And that's very strongly felt. And you know, there's particular focus currently on the Ballymurphy massacre that they will talk about, where the paratroopers over a period of days murdered a number of people, they would say, and that this was actually a policy. There is issues then they have around shoot to kill, that they believe was another policy that was applied by the state forces, to use their phrase. Now, I'm not sure how you get into all of that and find a way through it that everyone will sign up for, and everyone will say, well, yes, I can accept that. Or even, I've heard what you've said, I understand what you've said, I've put myself in your shoes. I'm not saying that I would have reacted that differently to you, but, you know, I still have a problem. And I don't think we ever get to the end of this where everyone says, well, I absolutely agree with you, it is as you say it was. We will always have, but the real challenge is, can you have the sort of truth-seeking and establishment of truth that allows these conversations to take place, that allows these realities to be accepted. You know, we look at the Stormont House Agreement currently, which is this huge piece of legislation that's about to be put through the House of Commons. Already Sinn Féin and the SDLP are indicating that the government in London is, rolling back from what it said originally, that they will in a sense, delete names, and they won't give the complete and open total information they committed to originally, and that's not acceptable. So, you know, all of this, every solution brings another problem. I go back to this mutual friend, Dennis Bradley, who I heard speak at an interview last week, and he said we really should try and wrestle these agreements away from the politicians, because what they will do is, I suppose in the nature of politics, they will try and cover every aspect, every detail, every line, every hyphen, to such a degree that it will become impossible to actually build the sort of dialogue that will be needed. And so I think there are really difficult periods ahead of us in making accommodations that address the past in a way that doesn't leave some people feeling, my story's never been told, I've never been heard properly. And I would be dishonest if I said I had the answer to that. I don't have the answer. That's a really difficult issue. John has his own view on it. I think he probably will share it with you.
The Stormonthurst Agreement was signed up to by everybody, and the British government has now drafted the legislation, 72 pages of it, which came out last week. I mean, things keep changing in this place by the day. Mm-hmm. And I only was able, before I came here, to have a very quick look at it. I mean, my experience has been this, that we lived through all this violence. We came to the Good Friday Agreement, and my expectation was, this is the watershed. We're now going to create a new future. And if we're going to create a new future, we have to be very careful we don't get obsessed with the past, with what we have come through. The danger, inside transition of justice, there are a number of different elements inside it. Quite a lot of it is in the process of being accomplished. The one bit of it which is the very difficult bit of it, has to do with the Historical Inquiries Unit, which is going to inquire into the past. I thought whenever we get the RUC transformed into the PSNI and that massive reform program going through, whenever you get large numbers of the people who served in the RUC taking early retirement and moving out of the organization, you get 50-50 recruitment, bringing Catholic people into the PSNI, that this was a major starting point. This is the new beginning. Then I suddenly discovered, no. We're going to go back and inquire into everything that the RUC did wrongly, or the Army, or the Special Branch, or whoever it is. And my problem is that this can end up being a highly selective inquiry into the past. Highly selective, and the people who were the out of which the primary elements of violence came out of loyalist and Republican paramilitaries. That you're not going to get the truth there, because where are the records? The actual records might exist in the intelligence agencies, but the British government is not going to open up all its intelligence files to anybody, in my opinion, or the Irish government. Now, they said in the Stormont Agreement they would. But then they're beginning to say, well, we can't start to put people's lives at risk. When you take Dennis Donaldson. Dennis Donaldson was a senior person in Sinn Féin. Then they discover that Dennis Donaldson was also working for the British government. He was an undercover agent for the British government at the very heart of Sinn Féin. Dennis Donaldson is outed, as they say, for the work he's doing. For his own safety, he ought to have been taken out of the country. But he goes to live in Donegal, and he's killed. Now, what happens if there are more senior members of Sinn Féin who are working for the British government behind the scenes? Are we ever going to discover that? Probably we ought not to discover it, because these people's lives might be put at risk. So there's layers of complexity in here. Now, I'm not an expert in this stuff. I've come to this as from where I'm coming from, which is a kind of a citizen, and somebody happens to be a Presbyterian minister. I buried some people who were police officers who were murdered. I know their families. I know the pain and hurt inside of that. I went down to a meeting once in that part of the over in the west in Fermanagh and Tyrone for a meeting one day. I was invited to go and meet with 60 or 70 widows. They are not a bunch of people with a big political clout behind them. They're quiet people. They've more or less come to terms with what has happened and their grief that their husbands and sons were shot, but they were mainly widows. They don't have a political campaign behind them. They're caring and loving and looking after one another and trying to put life together. So that's one bunch of people. But then you get another bunch of people who have a heavy amount of political activism in behind them, right? And the human rights agencies are concerned about their interests. And that's being driven it in a particular direction. So my fear is, if this is not handled carefully, it can open up old wounds that we have to be careful what we're trying to do here. Now, I have to say that I have lost the argument. Right? And then I'm going down my road, because I simply wanted us to try to move on. I talked to people, and great many individuals that I talked to say to me quietly, look, John, we can't deal with the past like this all the time. We've got to draw a line under it and move on. We have to do that. I think under the Stormont House Agreement says we're going to do this for 5 years. It's going to be intense 5-year scrutiny of the past. I don't, looking at the statistics, I don't know how you can do it in 5 years. Mm. You can't do it in 5 years. It'll take forever. And what's going to come out at the end of it, I don't know. So, I don't know. I have this feeling that I'm 76 years old. I don't want to spend the rest of my life looking at the past. I really don't. I want to spend the rest of my life trying to be constructively do things for the future, and not to be asked to revisit all this pain. The Savile Inquiry took, I don't know how long, 200 million to look after events in one afternoon out of 30 years. Somebody said, asked the question, what was the worst atrocity in the Troubles? And she replied, the day my father was killed. Mm. Right? And there's lots of those individuals out there. They're never going to discover who killed their father. They're never going to discover who was involved in setting their father up in order that he could be shot. Nobody's going to know that. And sometimes it's better you don't know. You don't need to know that your neighbour helped to murder your father. Do you? If all of that, or is that all going to come out? Well, I don't know that it is. But if all that stuff starts to come out, only part of it starts to come out, so you get soldiers named, RUC officers named, and some of them, you know, may in fact be subject to criminal accusations and go into court. So you put people in the old police service, the RUC police officers in court, and into the top levels of the government, you put the political representatives of people who were involved in extraordinary paramilitary violence, and they go into the government. There's a mismatch in here someplace. Now, my point of view on this is not one which is held by all the officials and the people who tell me they know what they're doing about these things. But this is what I feel, that we run in great danger of partially reliving the past all over again.
Maybe if I can ask you one last question here this morning, it would be to reflect back now that we're in 2015, and I think you were both saying there's been great strides that have been made in Northern Ireland, particularly in terms of community relations, but many miles still to go in some ways in addressing and dealing with some of these kind of key issues between the two communities. So again, looking back in 2015, is there any core lessons that maybe can be learned from Northern Ireland, maybe positive, maybe negative, for other societies that might similarly be trying to deal with a past history of conflict or trying to heal from a past history of conflict?
I think one thing we need to preface anything we say by saying I think every context is different. And I think the idea that there's some prescription that you can take from Northern Ireland and put it into the Central African Republic or into other parts of the world, like Kosovo or wherever, I just think is not appropriate. Mm-hmm. I think one of the key things is people designing mechanisms and models for their circumstance. But I think one of my key themes would be that you need to be very careful that these instruments or mechanisms don't become ends in themselves. That you keep a focus on what is our ambition here, what is our aspiration. John made a point that I think is very powerful around our leadership, our political leadership. What is their vision for this place? And constantly, and indeed importantly in the human sense, what are our values? What are the values that will inform what we do here? And to continually go back to those values to see in what we say and what we do, is that consistent with what we said our values were? And is that consistent with what our vision for Northern Ireland is? And if it doesn't fit, that we have the honesty and courage to say, that's not helpful. And we may disappoint people and we may hurt people in that, but we have to, in a sense, and this is constantly, it's a sort of a trite phrase, but you know, our future is now imprisoned by our past, and we have to move out of that past in as complete and comprehensive and fair a way and just a way as we can, but to keep our eye on the prize. You know, that we lose every year our brightest young people. They just, our young people are now disconnected to the point that they just say, I can't wait to go to college, but preferably I'll go in England or I'll go in Scotland. And then once you lose these people, when a Wyoming audience would understand this, they won't come back. They'll meet someone, they'll fall in love, they'll stay away. Now, we can't, you know, as a small, and again we have a lot of parallels with Wyoming, as a small place in a modern, very competitive global system, afford to lose that talent on the scale we lose it now. And unless we can make those young people believe this is a place where I have a future, where my children have a future, which is at ease with itself, to use my phrase. And so the lessons I've learned is that you can become a huge prisoner of the past, and I'm not in any way diminishing its importance, but you really do need to have a very clear view of the future you want to build, because that's what will, I believe, enable people to maybe let go of some of the hurt and say, well, there is a better place ahead of us. Let's try and move there, because where we are isn't helpful.
I suppose one of the lessons is that you go back to 1968 to 70, that necessary change is not resisted. It's got to be accepted and accommodated and welcomed. That you be very careful about going down a road of violence, because once you go down that road, it's very difficult to stop it. I never believed that violence was justified in what we've gone through. I think once you get the ceasefires, you're back where we were in 1968, but why go through all of that in order to go back to where you were? You know, so violence is counterproductive, I think, in Northern Ireland for progress. It inhibits progress. It does not facilitate progress. It inhibits it. You've got to be careful also about putting the politics onto the streets, because you can lose control of the streets very quickly. But that means that the people in political power have got to be providing a vision so that people on the streets know that progress is being made. They're getting someplace. And that we go through this constant job of trying to understand one another, and that the political leadership in the statements they make, in the attitudes which they have, in the casual statements that they make on radio and television, that these are not unhelpful, divisive, insulting statements, but are rather statements of generosity, of accommodation, of a future which we share together. So that we can begin to understand that that community, that bit of the community that we don't belong to, has got within it enormous riches, which we will never understand and appreciate as long as we are simply opposed to them. So that in the bit of the community that I come from, there are riches within that community. And in the part of the community that Tom comes from, enormous riches inside of that, that remain completely closed to me unless I get to understand and know that community. Now, the other element in this, which has been very important, is that the Good Friday Agreement was not just about the North. It was about the North and the South, and about the East and the West. There are these three legs to this stool, you know, and those three legs are very important, the internal ones in the North, North, South, East, West. Now, enormous improvement has been made internally in the North. Great, great improvement between the North and the South, and very considerable movement east and west between Ireland and Britain. So let's celebrate that stuff which has been achieved and keep building on it and move forward.
And I think just finally, on a positive note, I think a wonderful phrase again that I was reading recently is, reconciliation is when my enemy tells me my story and I'm able to say, yes, that is my story.
Well, I think that's a very lovely note to end on. And again, I just wanted to thank both of you. I know you have a very, very busy week here while you're visiting Wyoming and visiting the University of Wyoming, but just wanted to say thank you again for taking the time out this morning to talk with us and to give us a little bit of that insight into Northern Ireland. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your trip around the state.
Thank you very much. Yeah.